Kedgeworth, thank you for being on, and you can take it from here.
Perfect. Thanks, David. Okay, so I'm going to be arguing the position that psychedelics do indeed benefit well-being. And I'm going to do that through addressing a few core points, namely its therapeutic benefits, the benefits it has on mortality and the way we think about it, and of course with accessible spirituality. That's a term that I enjoy using. So the way I'm going to be doing this is initially what we spoke about in the debate, which is that I want to talk about how it affects things in society. So how it affects our communication with each other, how it affects the way we work, and essentially the way we interact. And I'm going to hopefully use all of these intense factors to lead to how psychedelics have the potential to better meaning in life. Grand claims, let's hope I can justify a couple of them. So to start with, let's talk about its therapeutic benefits. And before we dive into those, maybe I should start a little step before that, which is what is a psychedelic? Now, talk about just the substance format, we can list off names of compounds and molecules, but what does psychedelic really mean? It means mind revealing, or if you're off the other variety, soul revealing. What does this mean? So we can talk about what it means by talking about its counterpart, restrictions, mind constrictions. So let's talk. The way we can talk about psychedelics is by jumping into them. What does that mean? Once a psychedelic is taken, a person goes through intense experiences, from anything to auditory hallucinations, quite often visual hallucinations, and thoughts that people describe as chaotic, spiraling. Now, these words don't initially take off a positive outlook on the substances. So why is it that we're talking about them at all? Why is it that this question of drugs is brought up? Well, because by going through these chaotic events, these disruptions to our daily lifestyle, we're able to separate ourselves from the stories we tell ourselves. Now let's crack into what that means scientifically. So if we look at the default mode network, it is essentially a part of our head, without going into neuroscience off it, it is a part of our head that talks about our ego, our sense of self, what it is that we like doing, enjoy, how we love our family members. That region of the brain, after taking psychedelics, has been studied extensively. It silences that part. So what tends to occur is that a person experiences a loss of self. A commonly used term here is ego death. Why does that matter? Ego death is a state where, again, you lose a sense of self. When that occurs, you're able to get over these boundaries, these restrictions. A good example here would be medicinal use. So depression, for example. We know how depression is commonly treated. Cognitive behavioral therapy, walks out in nature. But it's about why do those things treat it? So when you're able to go out into a walk, when you go for a walk in nature, you're able to, the phrase is, clear your mind. Stop thinking about the same common loops that you continuously have. You're able to take in a breath of fresh air. Now, these metaphors can't just be left alone. They need to be critically examined. So if we go to the first point, as I mentioned, the therapeutic effect, we really take notice and we watch the complete drastic reductions in depression. I'm sticking to depression at the moment because we can go even a step further. Treatment-resistant depression. The way that we notice our current means of people who take these substances, that they're treated. The treatment-resistant part goes away, and they get over it. Now, this then stems into other fields. It is currently the best method we have of treating addiction. Now, this is for both alcoholism and nicotine. How can one drug, on one hand, be able to counter another drug, alcohol, cigarettes? It's because of the way this interacts with our heads. A really good segue into the next part, which is mortality, is how does this work? Let's go right to the end of a human life. The fear of death seems to cripple many people, including, of course, the young, and YOLO seems to come up, you only live once. But if we focus on why it is that people have a problem with death, we can start to see what occurs when psychedelics are put into the picture, and we have great case studies on this. Canada currently has a program where if you have a terminal illness, you can apply in this program and get psychedelics administered because currently they're illegal. We see very, very clear results on people's fear of death in situations where they know they're going to die. Those awfully anxiety-inducing situations are eased. the burden is reduced. Now, if we simply say that this is a compound you're putting into a body, of course, it's like a Panadol, a painkiller. It's meant to do something. It'll decrease your fear of death. So you take it and suddenly you don't feel as scared. That is not a complete picture, and that's completely missing the point of how it affects well-being. All of these changes that we've mentioned are not simply pharmacological, that you take it and there's something that happens within your body, like when there's a cut and you're healing, you're not actually focusing on the healing of that cut, it just happens. Just like when you take a Panadol, you're not focusing on it. No. These are journeys, entire experiences in the usual 5-hour period of a common psychedelic that you take, you go through an entire hero's journey, and out from the other side is not an instantly changed person. It's a person that's able to have a disruptive strategy that's entered their system, change them by making them go through these experiences, but that continuous change, which again, studies show lasts 6 months, a year, 2 years onwards, changes their moods, behaviors, attitudes, connections with their family members. And lo and behold, all four of these categories have to do with well-being. Mood, attitude, behaviors. Each of these fundamental aspects are affected drastically by psychedelics and the integration that comes after. Its therapeutic benefits are made rather clear. A common pitfall at this point is one of getting lost in, oh, there's the medical side of psychedelics, that might be all well and good, but we might be talking about the recreational side. What if someone just finds a mushroom and takes it? Is this really going to help their well-being? That objection I want to address really quickly. I'm not advocating for people to go about to their nearest shady person and find drugs. That is not the way to approach these compounds. They are serious compounds. They're not able to get you addicted. They don't kill you. They don't have these traits. What you need to do is use them responsibly. Research, learn about them, the same way that you'd learn about driving a car. A car has a much more likelihood of killing you and another person, but the research involved in, for example, learning about these substances needs to be critically considered if you are to have any therapeutic benefit on well-being. Otherwise, you can take it, just like how people have been and how recently people have been going to concerts, going to museums, and just having a good time on a really small dose. You have a good time, you see a few strange things, your vision is wavy, and then you go home and you go like, okay, cool experience, moving on. That's not what I'm addressing. I'm addressing core-founded research, which focuses on mystical experiences. We need to avoid the woo here, or at least I'd like to avoid it and keep it scientific for now, which is that mystical experiences aren't just a woo-related term. They're currently studied in Imperial College, in many institutions in the States where peer-reviewed research does emerge. So the mystical experience questionnaire is one thing that exists. We can quantify things like, do you feel unified with people around you? Do you feel a transcendent sense of self? These are all vague terms, but when you have a set of 20, 30, 40 questions like these, you can begin to associate an attribute of a mystical experience and learn from it. It is when you take a psychedelic and have a mystical experience, well-being benefits are clear. I don't think I'll have enough time to go into the last part of it in my opening, accessible spirituality, but maybe in the discussion we'll be able to go back and forth on that. And I think I'll rest my case there. Thanks.
Just as.
Thank you, cut off, David.
One sec. Can you hear me now? Yeah. One sec. My Discord's in.
No? Hello?
It should work.
Yeah. Yep.
Hello. Can you hear me? All right. So you still have 2 more minutes in your opening statement, but if you want to
yeah, I'd like to pass that over. Just in, I wouldn't want to run over and take any of his time.
Sure. So yeah, now then, thank you so much for your opening statement. Ozian, the floor is yours. You also have 10 minutes for any opening statement you want to make.
Hello, I'm Ozian, so I'm taking the con. But not necessarily the con, as in I'm seeing that there could not potentially be benefits to psychedelics, or that psychedelics should be illegal, or we shouldn't do any research in psychedelics or anything like that. My major contention is that people will pursue psychedelics when they should not. There are certain people that are predisposed to psychosis that psychedelics can aggravate, people can develop schizophrenia. They become disassociated with their ego, and that happens long term for some people that do psychedelics, especially if they do abuse them. I know I heard you say you weren't advocating for abuse of psychedelics. So some people do see positive benefits towards depression or towards addiction, but that's not the case for everybody. We still don't know a whole lot about how psychedelics will affect people long term. And I just do not advocate for people using it recreationally. I believe people should have be of sound mind, that they should be within their own ego, I guess you could say. I'm not really can't think of the right word for that. But that's really it. I don't have much else to say. I'm more interested in having a dialogue about the topic.
All right, then what we'll do is have a different layout for this. I'll set the timer because Ozian and Kedgeworth had close to 10 minutes left in combining their opening statement. We'll have a 30-minute discussion instead of a 20-minute one, if you're both okay with that.
Sure. I'd love to even go longer if Ozian has time, depending on how it's flowing.
Yeah, I have some time.
For sure, yeah.
I do have some questions for you, though. Maybe I can pick apart some of the things you said.
Perfect. I'd love for you to open.
For sure. So the timer started for that. We can go over if needed, but the stage is all yours, guys.
You said something that it does help depression. We know it helps depression, but I would say that's not always the case. There are examples and studies that show it can help depression, but not everybody that takes psychedelics is automatically cured of depression.
Oh, sure. We can jump into this first. So the reason why I focused on depression was I was also going to go to the extreme side of depression, which is what I mentioned, treatment-resistant depression. Now, as the title suggests, we don't currently have means of treating that. So it's either a deficiency of serotonin or just a complete confounded story that CBT and other therapeutic techniques aren't able to handle. Neither are they able to handle it when you throw in something like antidepressants, which we know have negative qualities. But if we really dive into the current research that we have, and since psychedelics have been studied again for a decade after the period of where it wasn't allowed, we notice that current data, peer-reviewed data, which isn't just in my country, UK, a lot of it is happening in the States, shows that it treats treatment-resistant depression. No one here is making the claim that it treats at 100% rate, but it's treating it at a rate which we have absolutely no other tools available for. So it's not that everyone who goes into the experience comes out a new and complete changed person. No, that was the mystical experience caveat that I mentioned, that if you are in a set and setting, if you're able to have responsible use therapists around, which is usually the study based case, then you are much more likely to come out. And that much more likely has a number. So it's above the 70% mark when you look at meta-analyses on this. So I'd say depression, wrapping it up, 70% mark is much higher than what we have. Treatment-resistant depression, we have a zero for that, as the name suggests. But for general depression, that is a very high rate.
Okay, good. What about the problems with psychosis? I know personally people that suffer from psychosis after taking psychedelics. Now, they abuse psychedelics, but they've been suffering from severe schizophrenia now for over 20 years. Is there any studies on that? Because I know that is a thing with psychedelics.
And there's no reason for me to deny it. It definitely is a thing. The studies, however, are lacking. Not because that people are scared of studying it. Sorry, not because that it doesn't exist, but it's what I just said, that people are scared of studying it. We know that people who have if you have a family history of schizophrenia, you are at risk of obviously developing it with or without psychedelics. We also know that psychedelics have a chance to trigger early symptoms of schizophrenia. So of course, if you are prone to that, this is part of the responsible use, please do not engage in psychedelics until more research is available. So that's a clear-cut case of schizophrenia. Do not engage with it. There is a chance of getting early onset of symptoms. But this is where we need to make something really clear. It does not develop schizophrenia in people who are not already susceptible to it or don't have it in their family history. There's never been a single case off that.
I agree. Like, I even think marijuana is not... People that are predisposed to schizophrenia shouldn't be doing anything... marijuana, any type of psychotropic drug at all. I've had brothers die because of marijuana. People want to say it's harmless, but there's so much misinformation out there about these type of drugs, and people think it'll cure anything. It's not a panacea. It does not cure everything. I'm okay with it being in a controlled environment. There's an interesting fact in Washington, D.C. I'm working there lately. They got a gift economy for drugs. So the city's made it legal where you can't buy like shrooms or whatever, psychobilin. I can't ever pronounce that word, but you can buy like a coffee for $50 and they give it to you. And they actually have clinics in Washington, D.C. with therapists on staff to administer the drug or let you administer it so they can be there to help you, like train psychologists and stuff on staff while you take psychedelics. And if people do want to experience that, that's how I would recommend that people do experience that, that they do it with trained professionals. They don't do it, you know, in the garage with their buddies, stuff like that.
Sure. So again, part of responsible use, I would definitely advocate if people have the chance to do it in an ideal condition, it would be with a therapist around, a setting that they're entirely comfortable in, and maybe a close family member or a friend who they feel really connected to. So having a trip sitter, a therapist, and of course, making sure that if you're in that setting, making sure the thing that you're taking is actually what it is instead of added compounds that you don't want in it. So we've just touched on the three things in this: schizophrenia, and like people who in the responsible environment, and making sure that you're taking the actual substance which you want to be taking. Those, I'd say, are the negatives on one side. We have them clearly listed out, labeled. What I want to do is focus on the positives, because the positives seem to get thrown under the bus here quite often, as they were, because the propaganda spread from the war on drugs. But if we focus on just the data at the moment, regardless of the millions of people who report online their trip reports, their testimonies, even though those are completely valid and should be considered, if we just look at the data, I know that you're on the same page of making them legal and have responsible use, but I'd push your definition. Your statement of only doing it with a medical professional present. I believe there's ways of doing responsible substance use by testing the compounds yourself, having a trusted family member or friend around, and taking it in a safe set and setting where you aren't, because of the benefits that come with it. Not only if you have a mental illness and you want to treat it, just because of the way it helps you reframe your life, the disruption strategies that come from it, the way you're then able to look at the relationships you have, and of course, what initially started our disagreement, the meaning in life that's developed. If you wanted to like push on that, you can. Otherwise, yeah. I could go on.
I do have two more issues.
Sure.
We did talk about schizophrenia, but also mania. So if somebody's manic depression, right? It can actually aggravate that too. But let's go. Somebody's not in their garage or whatever. They're not sitting there with a survey list of, okay, do you have a family history of this? Yes or no. Do you have a family history of this? Yes or no. Do you have any type of heart conditions? Yes or no. Have you had bad experience in the past? I mean, you see, it's to deal with responsible use of the drug, but people, if you go to a professional, and I'm not saying a professional needs to be somebody with a, you know, 8-year postgraduate education or something like that, but somebody who's actually familiar with the pros and cons of the possible side effects, how to deal with them, you shouldn't do these type of drugs without somebody like that present, in my opinion.
Okay, let's start at the beginning. So manic depression, and I think your second, you had that in it, like heart condition, or like if you've had problems or mania. We know that it's being used to treat very intense mental health conditions, like again, treatment-resistant depression, OCD was a recent study that it was treated in. We have addiction, of course, which is a crippling illness, and depending on what you're addicted to, well, anything in that regard. So we know that it's used and it is treated and it does have incredible results for those, yet you seem to be excluding it for people who have heart conditions and mania. There's no reported case of someone having a heart attack on these substances, as we know that physiologically they are not harmful. you cannot die from taking a huge quantity of them. You're more likely to be able to drink more water than you are, for example, let's go to marijuana, even though it's not a classic psychedelic. It'll take you a long time to smoke that much, if you can do it at all without passing out, as opposed to drinking water, which is likely to kill you. So that point about heart palpitations or heart conditions and mania aren't addressed. You can, of course, in the moment have what's known as a bad trip, but that's all it is. In the moment, you have a bad time, and if you're unable to integrate that later, you can develop something like, oh, I had a really bad time, and sort of a scarring experience. But with responsible use, you have someone that focuses on integration that comes from the trip after. So suppose you have a bad experience, which you would call bad, scary, terrors. You see demons, you see parts of like something traumatic in your past, and you relive that. And you're like, where's the positive? What did I gain from this that was worth something? Well, that's where the therapy comes in. Not necessarily at a therapist, but the integrative parts, like journaling, like developing a meditative practice, where you're able to learn from these terrors and actually develop resistances, develop healthy practices. And that's what tends to happen when you look at the studies.
You don't develop those healthy practices out of the blue. Somebody has to educate you on how to deal. And you don't need to take psychedelics to do any of that either. You can lead a healthy life without ever taking any psychedelics. So if you're saying you should take psychedelics because you suffer from some type of untreatable depression, or you suffer from drug addiction or something like that, then maybe psychedelics could be useful in that regard. So what's the benefit if you don't suffer from some type of ailment?
Sure. So that's what I want to focus on, because I would like to believe that most people don't actually have crippling mental health illnesses, even if they've been diagnosed. I'd like to think that we have a ways to go in psychology when it comes to classifying what you have and might not have. This is about the average person. Once informed use is done, you've made sure that your chemical is safe, you have a set and setting that you're comfortable in, you have a person there with you. You don't need things like mindfulness, meditation. You don't need a journaling practice before. A good quote by Aubrey Marcus was, I'm going to butcher it, but I'll give you the gist. What's the point in doing all of these practices if there's nothing, if you haven't felt the benefits of them? It's almost like you need to go experience something similar, and then you have a reason to put in all those years of meditative practice before you think a benefit will come out, or like sit and develop a comprehensive journaling practice and do it over time and not lose the habit. It's this frame breaking that a psychedelic allows for. So when you do lose a sense of yourself, your default mode network starts to weaken, which is something I wanted to push on one of your points earlier. When that does happen, you are then able to see things, quotes, the way they are, instead of associating all the stories that you have about them, how you like or dislike a certain thing or an attribute or a moral. You're able to go into these experiences, have a fresh, maybe even a terrifying experience, and come out of it with a sense of care, a sense of morality. A sense of care, a sense of love even. And from that, practices flow. So again, there's a study recently, I'd be able to link that to you, which is that people who come out of these experiences often report what people who are serial meditators report. And again, they've been brain scanned as well. While going through an experience, the gamma waves present in your head are extremely similar to the way that when people are in serious deep meditation. And we all know the benefits of meditation and what it provides. So suddenly, you have a reason for the average Joe to go through this, take the experience. It's not really guarded. This is part of the accessible spirituality part. It's not like you need to believe in something for years on end. No, it's responsible use. You take it, you sit through the experience, you have it, and suddenly you felt glimpses of what it's like to be a healthier person, a different person, yeah. One without all of the baggage involved. So the average person can gain from that.
Yeah, you're going from topic to topic, but that's okay. So I have 4 points with what you said there. So you're saying I'd like to address all 4 of them, but sure. You say that they can experience the way they are, but by definition, psychedelics don't make you the way they are. They alter who you actually are.
So
they don't experience how they actually are. They experience how they're altered to be under the psychedelic.
I think we're playing a little bit of a word game here. So let's continue that word game, and maybe we'll get to a result that we can both talk about. So an altered state of consciousness is not necessarily a higher state of consciousness. Sorry? Did we cut off for a second?
No, go ahead.
Yeah, so an altered state of consciousness is not a higher state of consciousness, which is another phrase that's thrown around. What is a higher state? How are you higher than me in a state of consciousness? No. So John Vervaeke, a cognitive scientist, talks a lot about these things. He has a 50-part series of Meaning in Life on YouTube. Great, please, recommendation. The point here is that when we talk about altered states, we're talking about disruptive strategies that come in. Now, what is that? Something that breaks the frame of the way you're viewing things, the default mode network. So again, we're going right back to neuroscience here. When you're able to do that, when you're able to go through that frame breaking, it takes away parts of the things that you're associating to other things. It's a bit unclear, so I'm going to give an example. So someone who has a fear of dogs, for example, fear is very often attributed to things in addiction as well. When you have, when you've built around stories of fear of quote unquote liking so much or loving the bottle that you're continuously drinking from or scared of like being without one, that is approachable. That is a story that you've told yourself, and you're able to, with psychedelics, with being in this altered state, go beyond that story. Witness it from a third-person point of view, the same way you do when you're meditating, the same way a qualified therapist would be able to show you. So it isn't exclusive to psychedelics. This is simply, as some quote, swallowing a therapist, yeah, if you, so you disregard Rule 34.
So I understand disassociating yourself from like fears of dogs and stuff like that and trying to change like the things that trigger you, and as you rightly pointed out, you don't need psychedelics to do that. So maybe some people do need psychedelics to do that, but if they can do it without psychedelics, I would recommend that they do it without psychedelics.
I'd like to try a challenge here because there's been I want to like turn around a little bit. We know that psychedelics have been used for thousands of years. We know that cultures have existed, places in Mexico, in the Amazon rainforest, many others that have used these compounds as they naturally grow from the ground. Things like LSD were recently synthesized from, again, a natural plant, ergot, and we know that they have been used, and they've been used in the past, and people have reported incredible experiences from them. So when you come in and you state that we should avoid these things and focus on modern technology and modern methods of dealing with them, I don't know if you focused on the modern part. Why is it that we should avoid them?
So you say with miraculous experiences or extraordinary experiences, but extraordinary experiences we don't know are actually true. So I like to live in the here and now, sort of the present. I don't like to alter my mind. I avoid, about the only thing I'll ever do is caffeine. And I'm not saying that people shouldn't take drugs, but they can if they want to, but to alter your state of mind, to me, that's not a miraculous experience. But so I just want to go back. So you're saying that they know who they are, but they're actually changing who they are. Even if they lose a fear, they're changing the type of person they are when they lose that fear. But that sort of is a semantic game. I just sort of wanted to point that out. But you also said it was similar experiences to serial meditation, and we all know the benefits of meditation. So I'm not necessarily certain we do all know the benefits of meditation. And if the, like, you know, the whole guru thing where you sit there and contemplate, like, there's different forms of meditation too, right? There's like sort of like presentism. There's the idea of where you contemplate things that happen in your past. There's ideas where you clear your entire mind, or you think about what's going on now and what you should do in the future. You could argue that all those are a form of meditation. Is to me, it's just about deliberation, taking the time to consider what's going on and what you should do in the future. So I don't necessarily know what you mean by meditation or the benefits of meditation or anything like that either.
Let's go into it because it is rather similar. So I'm not going to claim that when you're on a psychedelic, you're in a meditative state, but they do have overlaps, and people who do come out of these experiences do have similar reports. So again, the study that I was mentioning about gamma waves in serial meditators and people who take these substances, they made it very clear to not just focus on the benefits of psychedelics, but to focus on like, how is this happening and what is it that people feel in the moment? So meditation, unlike psychedelics, there was never a ban on studying them. The most current popular and popularized one, at least in the West, is mindfulness meditation. And I don't know if we can go too far into this or if we should, but the benefits are clear in the form of studies mentioning how quality of life changes, the way you're able to, again, appreciate parts of life which you didn't before, the way you're able to get over parts of stories that you tell yourself. Again, very like vague sounding terms. This is what we live from a day-to-day basis. We live how it feels to like drive home in traffic really late. We live how it feels to have like a crying baby nearby and being really, really annoyed, or like another person next to you is like really, really like cares about the kid, whereas you are sitting there annoyed. We know that these differences are present. And I guess since we're not really sharing screens here, I can't like pull up studies on meditation, but this, let's try to find more common ground then. So in therapy, do we both agree that therapy has significant benefits? Because if we do, get a simple yes here, then we can then move on to say that what does therapy do that psychedelics don't do?
Well, I just want to point out, I'm a stoic, so I do appreciate like the way I deliberate and the way I think and view the world. And I think we can educate people to view the world in that way. I don't think we need psychedelics to break that necessarily. Maybe some people it does provide benefit to. So you asked me if I think that therapy is beneficial. I think therapy is beneficial to some people. I think people just need to talk and be able to learn how to express themselves and how to evaluate reality that's happening around them. And that can be useful tool that you have, talking to a therapist to explore those ideas, to try to sort of ground your thoughts and experiences in what's actually happening and what's actually true. I don't see how psychedelics necessarily do that, except maybe it can break somebody from their, like, I don't know, you use the word, like, break their ego, so they sort of disassociate from who they are, so they can sort of look at the world a little bit differently than they were before. And
the terminology is making it so that we're sort of talking past each other. I didn't say break your ego. And I use the term ego death, which is, again, like a confusing terminology before we talk about it. So what it really means, isn't that you just like you're just this third person perspective when you take an experience and you're like looking down at everything from above, like, oh, okay, this is me. No, it's a lot more profound than that. When you go into these experiences, you are able to see things, not simply from a third person perspective. You go in and you see things fresh, a brand new pair of eyes. Even though you might have wavy vision, which you'll say like, oh, that's altered, that's clearly not real, nothing is wavy in front of me. No, it's the way that you come about associating the thoughts that you have with them. So if you're looking at a wall and it's wavy, and the thoughts that you're having when you're under these experiences are extremely contemplative, are extremely meditative. So I differentiate between these two. Contemplative as an external to you. Think about the universe, the way like society treats itself. Like sometimes you come out with the hippie mentality, even like a certain type of politics. But meditative then goes internally, just like how you said stoicism. So you're able to sit and, again, like you also said, you don't really need a therapist. You can talk to yourself a lot of the time if you're good at that. But a therapist comes in who's actually trained to probe and poke and actually use methodologies that get you thinking, that get you thinking in a certain way that tends to lead to healthier outcomes. So it's either Socratic thinking or cognitive behavioral therapy, which will come in through absolutely interesting ways. And it's all of this. The reason why it's important to talk about therapy is because it is a disruptive strategy. It is indeed altering your state of consciousness when you're going through these probing, intense questions that dive straight into your traumas from childhood, that go into what you absolutely hate. And the learning that comes from that is extremely similar to a psychedelic. So no, it's not just like being shit-faced after drinking, or like being very stoned where you're having just a bad time and you're losing your memory a bit, forgetting. These are deeper experiences, and those deeper experiences are again linked to mystical experiences. When you have both of those, you come out with benefits of well-being.
I've taken psychedelics before. I understand the experience, but I do think we should educate children to be able to cope with reality as well as children, instead of people taking psychedelics to try to, or seeing therapies. We're not teaching people how to, I think maybe religion has a lot to do with that, but that's an entirely different topic, and people don't learn how to cope with reality. Maybe psychedelics does have some type of benefit to cause this ego death as you're talking about. And I know I'm like the center of my own world, but I know that really doesn't matter too much either.
You're the center of your own world. What did you mean?
I experience everything everything I experience is centered around me, right?
Okay, so you're talking like first person perspective, everything. Like if you're sleeping, you're not going to feel something happening next to you. It was that simple point. So right. I guess, yeah, if I wanted to push a little bit on what you said earlier about you don't need psychedelics, you just teach kids about how to deal with the world, and like your point about religion, I don't know where you stand on religion, but I was very much a stone cold atheist. I've moved towards a little bit of agnostic side with my adoption of spirituality. Again, it has nothing to do with faith, it has nothing to do with dogma, it has more to do with experiencing things that are profound in ways that we cannot quite explain. So this debate that we're having, of course it's all well and good, but when it comes down to actually describing the experiences, we lose words. So going back to what you said earlier, you've had a psychedelic experience. I'm sure you have, the same way that I had a psychedelic experience as well earlier on in my childhood, where I had somewhat of a good time. I don't quite know exactly what you experienced, but for me it was a concert. I got to talk to friends, had some funky thoughts, danced a little bit, the end. This is again the mystical experience parts need to be added on to it. So we have the questionnaire that talks about it. We know what it feels like to have a quote-unquote mystical experience, which people talk about from all sorts of varying faiths. Like if you're a Christian, you have some imagery of Jesus or Mother Mary or whatever it is you've grown up seeing. If you're a Muslim, you have something to do with the Prophet Muhammad. All of these imageries doesn't mean to say that, oh, clearly, look, this person's thinking about Muhammad, this person's thinking about Jesus. How can they both be true? The simple answer is none of it is true, and you're just deluding yourself and you're not staying in reality.
Yeah.
I'm trying to strengthen that point as much as I can. The real point that I'm trying to bring across is that it is not about propositional knowledge that you gain from here. I mean, it's not about like what is true about the world. It's not like you will find out who God is, what his name is, what he wants. You can think you found it out, but that's not usually the case. It's more about the behavioral qualities you get from it, the participatory knowledge, the way you find out how things make you feel, the way you find you address your fears and the stress that you've had in the past, the way obsessive compulsive disorder works in your head, how it constantly makes you keep checking things over and over and over and over again. When you're able to really see and address that and feel a healthier way of living, that is where psychedelics come in. It's hard to describe that.
You're saying you should take psychedelics if you're healthy?
Yes.
Why?
I think because
if you're able to, so it can cause negative side effects for some people. Like, so that you can have a healthy person who takes psychedelics and causes psychosis because they didn't know they were predisposed to schizophrenia. Why should that person take psychedelics?
Good question. I think we might be talking past healthy. So if healthy just means like you feel happy in your life, your relationship, your friends, your family, sports, whatever other fields in your life, you feel content and grateful.
You're talking about profound experiences. I don't even know what that's supposed to mean anyways. I don't believe there's anything beyond what's natural and what's real that we can experience without psychedelics. So some people look at reality and they see it differently than I do. And maybe that's unhealthy with the way they view reality. And we need to teach them how to view reality correctly. Like, don't look for mysticism. Like, I don't understand what transcendental even means. Like, transcends what? Reality? All we have is reality. So, okay.
Do you agree that people view reality differently? You just said they do. Someone else will be looking at the same thing differently. Like a nice mug, it might be special to someone, but you could give two fucks about it.
Some people look out and they see God in as agency for everything that happens in reality. Some people do not. So some people add extra stuff. That extra stuff I would call transcendental, right? That we don't need when we view reality. So if psychedelics are causing you to see some type of agency between events that we can't measure or detect or determine is real, then I would recommend you never take psychedelics because those aren't real. If that's what you mean by transcendental or profound, like that stuff's not real.
Okay, let's talk about what is real and what isn't. So I see theists use this a lot, and I feel... I'm just going to bring up the argument instead of patronizing myself for it. So, love, for example, people bring this up quite often, the love that you feel for your mother, the love that you feel for your spouse, it's not quite quantifiable, it's not quite real unless you talk about traits around love. So we know what love is like. We know that one part of love is wanting them to be healthy, wanting them to be happy. Those are what we can collectively come across and say that that is what we think love constitutes, amongst a whole lot of other romanticism, which may or may not be directly defined by love. Now, how do we know if the love that you have for your spouse or your partner or your mother is real? We look at those things. We're like, do you care about them? Do you want them to be happy? The same way we come to mystical experiences, that do you think that you're transcending something? Do you think that you feel a sense of unity, a sense of connectedness with the world? Now, all of those points could be bullshit. There might be absolutely no sense of connection between humans without, like, communicating with each other. It could be entire garbage. The point isn't to focus on that. The point is to focus on the well-being benefits that come alongside that. So let's talk about religion a tiny bit so I can help. Let me steel man that a little bit. So the sense of community that people who are religious feel is tends to be stronger than people who are atheists, because religious people tend to create stronger communities. Whether that's the case that it's real or not doesn't matter. It's just the case that it is. So if you claim that you're having this unnecessary thought, you're just putting God into the picture, and like, you don't need that to view reality. I view reality this way. Sure. But the benefits that follow those may or not correct beliefs are clear. Well-being benefits are clear.
All right. So we do have, like, some empirical evidence of what love is. We have some ideas about chemical bonds, especially between children and parents and like that. We can do brain scans of what love looks like when people are experiencing love, right? So we do have some data beyond just anecdotal explanations of how people feel what love is. And now, of course, it's underdetermined.
So when you look at a brain scan, you might talk that it's current limiting technology that we have, but when we do look at a brain scan of someone who is supposedly in love, does it give you the entire picture of how they feel? Or do you get the picture from them describing their experience to you?
So you're talking about two different things. You're talking about how they're experiencing what love is versus actually what love actually is.
How do we differentiate that? How do we know what love actually is?
It's empirically.
Do we have the data that says this is precisely love? All of these chemicals that are firing off in your head means that this is love. Where someone who has a slightly different set of chemicals means it's not love.
Maybe. Yeah. But it's all underdetermined. So we don't know. It's underdetermined. Underdetermined means it is natural. We just don't quite know all the steps that go into understanding what it actually is.
Yeah, at this point, I just wanted to mention that we did use up that 30 minutes of back and forth. I know there aren't any questions that were sent to us in the chat here. So if the audience does want to extend this back and forth, if any of the audience members can let me know, or if there's any questions you guys just want me to direct to them, we can head to the closing statements.
Is that what you'd like to do, Ozin? Go to the closing statements, or did you want to finish up the discussion we were having, or bring up a point that you didn't?
I did want to bring up. I did not prepare for this. I've been working like 14 hours a day for the last 2 weeks. So,
that's awful.
Yeah, I know. Well, I made money at least, right? But I guess we just go to closing statements. I'm okay with that. Maybe we can talk about it another time when I'm more prepared to talk about it.
Sure. Since I went first, would you like to go with closing?
So I'll just set the timer to 5 minutes. Whoever wants to go first for their closing statements will get the 5 minutes.
I'll let you finish, Kedgeworth. It's okay. But I just want to say that I'm a proponent of drug legalization for all drugs. I'm a proponent of not criminalizing behavior or people doing psychedelics if they do choose to do psychedelics. But I also do not advocate for people to actually do drugs unless there's actually a medical reason for them to use it. They actually have some type of disorder. I prefer people that look to talk therapy, look to behavioral therapy and things of that nature before they turn to any type of mood altering or psychedelic type of drugs. And that's and I enjoyed the conversation, and that's my closing statement.
Thank you for saying that. I enjoyed the conversation as well. I really, really wish we could have gone on, but like you said, we can go on a bit later. I'd like to address in the closing, even this might not be the best practice, but I'd like to address some points that I didn't manage to get across. So essentially, we ended by talking about what is real and what isn't, and I started talking about love. And I understand that maybe limiting technology, and maybe in the future, 100 years, 200, 1,000, we'll find out what love precisely is, and we'll be able to notice whether someone is in love or not. But I don't think that'll quantify, and that's, of course, the problem that we have of what is consciousness, the hot problem of consciousness that'll come up, is that these particular states that we're noticing don't exactly correlate to the experience that one has of, for example, tasting chocolate. So it's the same thing here. When we talk about how it is to feel good, how it is to feel amazing, how it is to feel alive and feel meaning, we only talk about it in regards to other experiences that other people have. And we can then find what is common in those experiences. So something that I didn't get to mention, unfortunately, is like meaningful experiences. We know what general meaningful experiences are, like the death of a parent when you're there and you're going through that grief and loss, or more likely the positive side of when you're holding your firstborn child. That is extremely meaningful. And we know that because most people report it. It's not just simply that we have the brain data to show that it's meaningful. But again, here we have brain data for psychedelics that show that, again, when it comes to things like meditation, when it comes to things like depression, healthier brains pre-depression and after, healthier brains post-addictions, we see people not only report benefits and, betterments in well-being, we see brain scans. We see their actual themselves get healthier, not only with their attitudes, the scans, but also the behaviors. So these meaningful experiences that I mentioned earlier, death of a parent, holding your firstborn child, falling in love for the first time, are more often than not, in the millions of trip rewards that exist, people compare having their first psychedelic experience, first mystical psychedelic experience, to that. Now, if we go about saying, this is just a quote that I'd like to bring up, just to put this into perspective, by Terence Mckenna, going to the grave without having a psychedelic experience is like going to the grave without ever having had sex. So we are missing a fundamental, monumental part of what humanity did for thousands of years in the past. I'm not relying on the fact that it's simply an old practice. I'm relying on the fact that it is currently still a meaningful practice that has clear medicinal benefits and clear benefits to people's well-beings overall, even when they do not have any diagnosed mental health illnesses. The disruption strategies, the frame breaking, the absolute hero's journey is clear. People learn from them, and people grow from them, not in the 5 hours that they're there, but the rest of their lives. So I really hope that you guys had a nice time listening to the two of us, because I had a lovely time. Thanks.
I appreciated your knowledge.
Thank you. I appreciated our talk. I appreciated you like poking me a lot with your questions. Thank you.
Yeah, and I thoroughly enjoyed the discussion as well. As someone who really likes this. So this, I actually recorded this entire debate. So thank you guys for coming on. Both participants will get a link to this video, and I'll also put debate up in the suggested videos channel in this Discord as well. But now I don't think we actually need to move anywhere to like a another channel, but I think we can have an open show, like an after show right here, if any of the guests want to.
Yeah, I'm willing to talk to people and open it up.
I hope people want to talk. We didn't get that many, but hey.
I'm sure Elusive has something to say.
I haven't had the pleasure of talking to him.
Maybe not.
So yeah.
I just kind of jumped in on the end, so I'm just kind of catching up.
Oh, David left. Hey, Elusive, what'd you think, even though you joined at the end?
I don't know. I feel like I missed kind of your guys' main points, so I was still kind of trying to follow each of you. So
I didn't really make any main points. He made most of the main points. I just sort of poked at it a little bit that maybe people shouldn't do it without medical professionals involved. or at least somebody trained involved.
I mean, I guess it depends on what the science ends up. I haven't dug too far into the science on psychedelics, so in terms of risk, I mean, if science deems it's not something that's terribly risky to the average person, I don't know why you'd need a medical professional.
Sure. Yeah. So just quick rundown of the science. It's used to treat things for addiction. So there's no like people initially think there's an addictive potential off these things. And there's like, oh, can it kill you? There's no reported case of the substance in any of the main classic psychedelics like killing you. So one of the points that Ozian Lovely brought up, which was schizophrenia, there's a chance that you take it and you develop schizophrenia, and I like was able to address that with like, it's only if you already have a family history of it occurring, then there's a chance it brings forth symptoms that you would anyway get. And that's why there aren't too many studies on it, because they clearly phase out these people who have a family history of it. So the reason why you'd want, I wouldn't say you need a medical professional there. I'd say you'd need someone, like, and it's commonly known as a trip sitter. You'd want them there just for company, for help, because these are very, very challenging experiences usually, especially if you take a higher dose, which is what leads to the mystical well-being beneficial trips, which is you want someone there to talk to be there for you, someone you're comfortable with. That's a therapist or your mom?
I don't mind sharing. I have some family history with this issue here in particular, where my brother decided he had schizophrenia and he decided to self-medicate with marijuana. And he decided he was going to tell the police to shoot him and kill him. And he wouldn't do what they said, and they did shoot him and kill him. I have another brother that OD'd on fentanyl, and I have a third brother who suffers from psychosis from abusing LSD and shrooms and stuff like that. But we have a family history of schizophrenia, so it sort of makes sense that he would be predisposed to that.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, I'm not saying it's a drug's fault. I'm, you know, but the it's a misinformation's fault, right? People, you were misinformed.
They definitely were. Again, I'm really sorry to hear that. It affected me a lot.
Yeah, I'm not blaming.
Sorry, it threw me off. I don't know how to. Yeah.
You don't need to respond. It's life, right? Reality. But now with my father, he suffered from dementia for probably his last 10 years of his life. And one of my other brothers was, the VA put him on microdosing and it helped. And then my brother would trip with him like once a month on shrooms and it helped. Like when he did the trip, like heavier doses, it seemed to help him, like if he did it once a month, than just the microdosing.
What did it help him with specifically?
His cognitive function, his ability to communicate, his ability to remember, stuff like that.
I'm really glad to hear that. But you're right. Now I've found, Lawrence, you're right. It definitely is about misinformation that if people don't know and they just hear if it, like you said, a panacea, and that'll cure everything, you just pop it and you're done. You're likely going to have a bad time. And afterwards, if you don't have integration tools around, you're not going to learn anything from the experience. If anything, you'll just have like, oh, I had a really scary time scarred. And then you have a bad interpretation of what these compounds are. Or in your brother's case, a much, much worse fate, which is like we want to avoid. So misinformation, this needs to be dealt with responsibly. That's what we need to, like, at least me, it's really important for me to talk about this because of the profound effects it's had on me, my close friends, and the fact that I read millions of these trip reports. I haven't gone across to even maybe 1,000 yet, but the fact that they exist and like going through studies about them, they fascinate me. I know there's, for lack of a better term, magic around, whether or not that's naturalistic, or we'll find out in the future that, like, sorry, if we'll find out in the future that it is completely like predictable what'll happen depending on your past. But the sense of wonder and the way you look at life afterwards is entirely different after a mystical experience, and it's almost always positive. People who come out of this report that, and their behaviors demonstrate it for years after, so it isn't a temporary effect.
Yeah, I did LSD probably a dozen times, several times. I did it with friends, like peers at the time. And I was like 20, I think, at the time. 19 to 20. And I didn't like it. So I did not like not having control over my faculties. I could sort of force myself to have control. And maybe that's just part of my nature, is I want to have control over my faculties, and I don't like giving up. I mean, you described it as ego death, and I resist that even when I'm on psychedelics. It makes me feel uncomfortable. Same thing with drinking alcohol or smoking weed. I cannot stand that feeling.
So it's a very similar feeling for you, the sense of like, I'm losing, I'm feeling dizzy, or I'm feeling like I'm going somewhere, and I don't want that. I want to stay here, present. And that's why. But why did you do it a dozen times then?
Probably peer pressure, I imagine.
All right. Well, I did them a couple times myself early on, and I didn't really get much from it. In fact, I had a really terrifying time with my fiance, where I was in the moment, I was just like, oh, it might just be better to die rather than have this. Like, I lost my memory. I couldn't quite think straight. And I was just scared. I was like, will I ever go back to normal? But from that experience, when I came out of it and I was able to integrate it, I developed my meditative practice, which all my friends and family, if you speak to them, or if that matters as a data set, they report that I've become kinder, more empathetic as a person, more like just generally better. And I feel that way too. And I think my behavior demonstrates it as well. And I'm like, fortunately, I'm not in the minority here. People who do have these intense experiences that like sit by themselves, not like a fun dose at a concert or you take it at a movie, where you actually take a strong enough dose, you sit and you experience the trip. Those experiences that you come out of are the transformative ones.
How would you feel if somebody took your advice and did psychedelics tonight, and he suffered from psychosis?
I would really, really hope that they heard the caveat of don't do it if you're prone to schizophrenia. Then if they did hear that and they chose to do it anyway, and then it would be an awful shame. That's why I want to be really careful when I talk about this, and I talk about responsible use, and you research what you're taking, hopefully have an intention set, because that is an important part of leading to a possible mystical experience, and then you do it right.
Yeah, so not everybody knows if they're prone to schizophrenia or not, right?
Yeah, not everyone knows, but hopefully they've checked in the family, like they know it's close family. It's not like, oh, your great grandma had something or your aunt something had. It's more so like if you're closely related to someone with schizophrenia, that's what this small data set has shown. But from the hundreds of thousands of people who've currently taken this in a scientific setting, no one's developed permanent psychosis. No one's developed any sort of schizophrenia. It just hasn't happened.
But there are some people that don't have a history of schizophrenia in their family that do suffer from schizophrenia. It's not always correlative.
You can develop it, yeah. But that's that goes to show that you would develop that anyway. It's the onset that comes, the symptoms that come earlier. So of course, like, it's your life. You wouldn't, if something bad is going to happen, you wouldn't want it to happen earlier, right? But you would weigh that. What are the absolute minority, like minor chances of you having this, developing schizophrenic symptoms versus the well-being benefits that I outlined? And I wasn't clear, because there weren't any minds changed on this debate. At least it didn't feel like it. That the well-being benefits are clearly present. The way you just like realize your love for your spouse is much greater than it was in the past, like just that alone could be worth this transformative experience, which again has been done for thousands of years.
I don't want to change the way I feel. It just seems like counter to my nature, but I understand if people want to do that.
So I want to push there a bit. Like, you don't want to change the way you feel. So you've decided on all the feelings you're going to have for the rest of your life, and you know for a fact that they're the right amount, let's say.
I don't know what's the right amount. I feel comfortable with the feelings I have. I think you vanished. Did you vanish?
Elusive left, I think.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so you feel comfortable with the way you're at. That is a lovely thing for people to achieve, right? But I think there's parts of your life, just like every single other person on the planet that they're not as comfortable with, whether that's their expectations of their career, their love life, kids. So it's about addressing those things, that like these fears or these problems that you've like built up in your head that may or may not be like physically there, like a broken leg. Can you address those in ways? Can you do that through meditation or therapy, or like just waiting 5 years until the feeling you forget about it? So this is one of the tools like that we know that works, and well, that you can have a profoundly meaningful experience from.
Well, I think it goes to my stoicism. I don't think my will can affect the world. Like I think I can only control what I have the ability to control, and I don't stress over things that I have no ability to change. Like, so maybe just my outlook on life is much different than, it is obviously much different than most people. So I don't like view things. If I wanted to change the way my nature, I would change it, but I don't think it's possible to even, there's nothing about my nature I'd want to change. It wouldn't be who I am.
Nothing about your nature you'd want to change, it wouldn't be who you are.
Yeah, if I changed my nature, weren't always my nature would be stoic. Different.
So you changed your nature to go to stoicism.
I don't know if I haven't always been a stoic. I remember being 5 years old and questioning this type of things. I just couldn't identify what it was when I was five.
Okay. And I'm not going to ask, like, do you feel like you're a perfect stoic or anything? But like the phrase you mentioned, like you don't, you're fine with not changing the things you can't change, and you focus on what you can change. That's like, it's probably an ideal way to live, unless you're an idealist where you'd want to change everything, even though you know you can't. But it's not that. Let me try a different angle here. I don't know how much time you have, but I'm enjoying this. Like, meaning, what we talked about in the chat earlier, where you called it sort of nonsense. Like, why is it that you think that this, like, psychedelics can't help you find more meaning in life?
I don't know what you mean. Like, meaning. I have meaning in life. I don't know what more meaning would mean. What does that mean?
Okay, so the two examples I said, like, have you, by any chance, do you have kids?
Yeah, I have three.
Okay. Did you feel like your life became more meaningful the first time you held your first child?
No, not really. It added to my life. I wouldn't say my life became more meaningful. I would say, like, it was an experience I preferred. It was a good experience.
So, would you call anything? Did any event or thing make your life more meaningful?
I mean, I like to say the best thing I ever did was join the Navy. The second best thing I ever did was get out of the Navy and then having my kids and stuff like that.
Okay. So,
well, I don't know what that means. I just say that because that's just the way my life turned out to be.
Events that you said, like joining, leaving, starting a family, those were core in your life, which is why you remember them. So they did, maybe meaning isn't the perfect term to know with our conversation. Did they, different one, like, did they make you feel like you had a purpose?
No more of a purpose than I already had. My values, my priorities changed when I had children, so... I mean, there's still a priority to me.
They gave you, like, your actions changed because, like, they were more meaningful to you than the previous things that brought you meaning. Like, I don't know, going out with your friends became less meaningful than taking care of your kids.
Well, I've never found value or meaning in having things. So I always found value and meaning in making things better for other people. So the fact I had children didn't really change that. It just changed who I wanted to improve outcomes for, which was for my children.
It was really nice to hear.
That makes sense. So, yeah. I grew up raising or helping to raise four younger siblings. Unfortunately, two of them are dead and one's homeless. But I'm 50, dude. Like, I'm not young. But
I'm 26 myself. Yeah. I I'm really glad that you're like it adjusted your focus at the very least to caring more about making the world or like their environment a better place. So
well,
that,
I always, for them, but I always valued making the world a better place for everybody. It's not like I changed my values. Like my values, I don't know if they've really fundamentally changed that much. I view more that the people around me, like their value, because they don't have like foundational beliefs, right? That their values change like with the wind, it seems like, or at least the values they profess to have sort of change with the wind.
I don't know if I can judge those people. Yeah, different topic, I guess. So I think more so it's that since your focus was always the same, it's not that like you've done psychedelics, so I'm sure you have your perceptions built about them already. It's not like you need to go in and like change something fundamental about yourself. It could just really be like in the earlier example, which is like you love your kids more, your spouse more in ways that like you thought you love them, but this way sort of like gets rid of the bullshit, cuts, like that's a disruptive strategy by its very nature. When a therapist like sits down and like makes you probe into like, when did you love them the most? How did that make you feel? How did you dive into that experience? And then what did you get back from it? And you know, the techniques that they use, that alone can then push into what psychedelics do, which is that it makes you like, instead of talking to someone where you can like filter your words and like not want to do it, this is sort of like an introspective experience where you're sort of forced to go places when depending on your intention, like go into states which you want to focus on. So like, hey, you love your kids, you want them to be happier. Why is that? What is it that you can really do? So another thing which I didn't mention was like insight. In the people who do psychedelics, like you've probably heard Silicon Valley, like they take them, they think of cool inventions. What was the old CEO of Apple? He took them, part of it. So like you gain understandings that you didn't previously have. You have those aha moments. So on one side, you have the aha moments and you learn something new and that changes your life. And on the other side, you have what you already believed and felt, and that you feel that stronger, you feel it truer. That's what I think people can get.
Yeah, maybe it's beneficial to some people, and I think I sort of admitted to that even before we started the conversation. I'm not saying it's not necessarily beneficial to some people, but it seems to be that you're advocating that everybody should take psychedelics, and I don't necessarily agree with that. Except
I
maybe
caveat it with like 99% of the pop who like who, because 1% would be, you know, the responsible use we talked about.
I want to talk like manic depression too. I've read like bipolar disorder, stuff like that. That I've read that psychedelics is probably not. It can actually potentially make those swings worse, especially like marijuana or something like that.
Marijuana has the chance to, of course, like the paranoia element of marijuana definitely has the chance to induce manic episodes, but I haven't come across a study. I'm going to Google this right after, probs, because I haven't looked into anything about manic episodes, bipolar disorder with psychedelics. But from the data that I've gathered and the sort of the strategy behind the data was that, why is it so good at addressing like depression, OCD, addiction? Like, what the fuck does it do? So from that framework, one of the theories by Carhart-Harris was that these are possibly defense mechanisms. They're not so rooted that like, oh, you look at someone's head, you see these like chemicals over here, that means like, aha, they have OCD and they need to be treated by chemicals or a certain like phrasing or talk therapy or whatever. It's more so story based, as like the conservatives used to think that, oh, this is just some bullshit you're telling yourself. It's not entirely that. Sometimes there are serotonin deficiencies, but from the model that we're working with right now, most of these things are defense mechanisms. So when it does flare up a manic episode, it might even flare up much more intensely on a psychedelic, but because of its nature of addressing your default mode network, silencing it eventually, you're able to look at that differently and feel it from a way you hadn't felt it before and come back and address it better in therapy. So that's what I'm assuming happens with that, even though, like I said, I haven't come across that study.
Yeah, so the cautionary tale I would give is they should stay on their medication and talk to a therapist before they tried anything like this. Somebody with mania or schizophrenia or anything like that should not, anybody with any type of mental illnesses or anything should just not jump to psychedelics as some panacea.
Definitely not as a panacea, because then it would be almost snake oil. You just have like a weird time, like you've had, like I've had.
People were actually saying that marijuana would cure broken bones, because there's one person.
That sounds so fucking stupid.
There was one story that this person had a fracture that wouldn't heal. They started smoking weed, and their fracture eventually healed. I'm like, whatever, dude. Or they'll say that there's no, like you're saying, like there's no addictive qualities. But I know that people that, even with like, and I know marijuana, it has psychoactive elements, right? And there could be other things in marijuana that are causing, you know, other things to happen. But I know people who do have addiction to marijuana.
Oh yeah, of course, you can get physiologically addicted. Like you can get addicted to sugar, for example, or like having one meal that you really like. Like addictions exist in everything. But that's more so up here, right? Like you've developed an attachment to it. You've told yourself a story that you can't live without it. Okay. It's not like alcohol, where if you drink too much and you drink over a period of time, if you stop drinking it, it'll kill you. Or like heroin, which has that genuine like sweats and withdrawal effects. It's more like up there.
I know.
And just a small thing about psychs is that if you do them constantly, like LSD, for example, if you do it constantly, you need to up the dosage a lot to a point where it just won't work anymore, or it'll give you a very, very minor effect, which, like, what's the point of then doing? So it has that built in. Marijuana doesn't. You can just do it every day, multiple times a day.
Well, there's people that I think is some hyperthalamic thing they can develop because of excessive marijuana use, where they get like colds, chills or sweats or whatever. They have to take warm showers and it doesn't help them. Yeah, there's it's rare. Anyways, just there, it's not a net what's the word I'm looking for? There's not like there's no negative consequences to these, and we say there's no addictive qualities to these psychedelics, but like you've also pointed out, we haven't done a lot of studies to know, like, it would 5 years right. With the percent, like maybe 2%, maybe it's 4-5%.
Sorry, I didn't catch. What are you talking about percentages?
So maybe with psychedelics, you know, we haven't done enough studies. Maybe habitual use over 5 years, and there'll be a certain percentage of people that have serotonin reduction.
Oh no, we have those studies for sure, because like we've done them over a decade, and then we also have trip reports, which again counts as observational data that we can gain over, like, when you have enough of that data and you filter out the garbage. So we have it. We know that it doesn't just develop that serotonin deficiency. It does, with going back to what you said, when you take it with medication that you're already taking, generally SSRIs, antidepressants, if you take it with that, there is a chance to cause serotonin syndrome. So people need to be really careful if they're taking it with that, like. You need to taper off of that first, because, like, side note here, if we like look at what antidepressants do, we have actual studies that show, like, antidepressants, the thing that are supposed to help your mental health, one of the side effects on some of them is suicide.
I know.
Like, fucking jokes. Yet we still we come about high on our horse and say, hey, you should take your meds that the doctor gives you, even though we know psychology is a relatively new field and we know of these problems that clearly exist. We know the numbness that comes from it, the loss of appetite, the, like, all of that, especially the suicide, yet we still say, take your meds.
We don't even quite know what simple depression really is. I mean, I don't want to say that we don't. I don't want to just, like, devalue people's experiences with depression and stuff like that. I mean, mania, right? Manic depression, we sort of have an idea what's going, some idea what's going on, but, like, just simple depression, but people get medicated for all the time. It's not necessarily clear the medication is the best option.
Or even if the diagnosis was the correct diagnosis.
Yeah.
Maybe that DSM needs a few more numbers attached to the end.
People like think there's emotions that are negative. I don't view any emotions as negative. I don't think anger is negative. I don't think depression is negative. I think there's things you experience when you need to.
I think I'd differentiate, like, depression, we still can't, like, point out what it is. We can, like, list again those terms. But yeah, anger, for example, it doesn't need to be negative. It can be channeled appropriately, or it can be sat with and, like, learned from. So yeah, we're on the same page.
Well, like sadness, let's say, you know, people are sad, so they think they're depressed. But sadness is a normal response to loss. So it's normal to experience these emotions, and people try to...
a healthy way of doing it, of looking at it. And like a lot of times people are just so lost. It's like, I'm fucking sad, bro. How can you say that's not negative? Look at me. But so this helps frame breaking disruption.
Yeah, I've always advocated that you should experience your emotions. You shouldn't suppress your emotions. And if you do experience your emotions, to me at least, I tend to, because I've learned how to process emotions over the last 50 some years, that I don't like suffer because of the emotions, right? I experience them. I cry when I need to cry. I laugh when I need to laugh.
And you live with them fully. Like, I would say that you are living those emotions. You're feeling them deeply, which is one of the insights that people tend to come out from psychedelics with. So, hey, there you go. You don't need psychedelics.
Well, that's what Stoicism teaches too. It teaches you how to teaches you how to experience your emotions, right? And not try to control the environment to get rid of the emotions, because you can't.
Of course. Can't always do that.
Yeah. You can walk away sometimes, but sometimes you can't walk away. You have to learn how to deal with the emotion. And you shouldn't ignore it. It's a real thing. Like, but you should understand that if somebody's not making you feel a certain way, you're feeling a certain way because it's a natural response to what's going on outside of yourself.
That's a natural response that you've developed over the years of being alive. Like, this is how you're viewing things, and that's why it feels natural to you.
Yeah, and you can change those triggers too. Like, some things you can evaluate this. Oh, it's irrational to be afraid of a dog because a dog is small, right? And you know, but people do have irrational fears, and they don't. When you're in the moment, you don't recognize it as irrational.
Of course not.
And we don't teach people these coping mechanisms. We don't teach, and maybe it's impossible to teach everybody. Maybe they do need some type of drug intervention, or they need therapy or something like
education to start with. I think the drug intervention can wait until people are older, and it's not that they need it. It's that it could enhance what they already have, or help fill in the gaps where they're human and they haven't done the work themselves.
Yeah, I
like this part of our discussion like a little bit more than I like the debate, because I'm sure you've noticed you've done a lot of these. I'm assuming that like this debate formats, they don't allow for as free form of a conversation as we're having now.
Well, I was trying to push you a little bit, even though I wasn't prepared. And you were rambling a little bit. So it's like you're going like five or six topics, and it was more educational. And I'm okay with that. I it's okay.
Sure. I appreciated the challenge. And about the rambling part, I'll take the hit.
It's okay. if you were like educated, if it wasn't a debate, like it would be great for like an interview, right? If somebody was to interview you on the topic, then that format would, I think you would be great in that type of format.
Sure. I aim to get better. Let's call it here. What were you saying? I don't want to cut you off though.
People tend to like Gish Gallop. They'll like touch on like five or six different points, and it becomes impossible to address every point. It comes off as a tactic, is all. So, I'm not saying
I'll try to be more wary of that.
I don't think you were trying to do that.
And that might help too.
I don't think you were trying to do that. I just think it's your nature to do it. Some people do it as a tactic, is all. I appreciated the conversation, man. This is a voice chat, so I think we can just leave.
Yep.
Okay. I don't think we have to end it unless there's a stage manager here that can tell me.
I think we'll just leave. Okay.
Yeah. All right. Later. Take care.
Bye.